I'm very delighted to present to you, to introduce to you, our next speaker, Professor George Katrougalos, also from Greece. George Katrougalos is a professor of public law at Democritus University in Greece. He has written, among many things, a number of monographs, books, such as Crisis and Way Out, Social Policy and Social Rights at National and International Levels, Southern European Welfare States, and other books. He has also worked as an international expert on human rights in a number of countries and in collaboration with the United Nations. And he has been invited to lecture at a number of foreign universities such as the Columbia University, Humboldt University, Tilburg University, and London School of Economics. In this presentation, George Katrougalos will try to answer the question whether what is happening now in Greece is something distinct, or whether we should, or whether when we are looking at Greece, we see the mirror of Europe. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Professor George Katrougalos.
First of all, let me express my sincere thanks to the organizers, not only for inviting me, but for setting up such a multicolor, multifaceted event. I have chosen to start and to end with some poetry. Some of you may find exaggerated the tone of these verses. You are going to think that Europe is not so bad, after all. And maybe some of you are going to find the title of my presentation a little preposterous. What has a failed state like Greece to do with the future of Europe? I'm going to proceed to the presentation of my speech in three steps. First of all, I want to show you what is exceptional exactly in Greece by making a small historical reference to the past. Then, I'm going to associate this issue with the main theme of our conference, freedom of information, transparency. Then I'm going to pass to the austerity measures imposed to us by the so-called memoranda and the Troika, and I'm going to finish by trying to show to you why this is not something unique to my country, but something to be expected throughout Europe. There is some truth about the exceptionalism of Greece. The Greek political system is in fact exceptional, atypical, with regard to the average European political system. Sometimes we attribute this exceptionalism to corruption. We say that the Greek political system is corrupt. This is not exactly untrue, but it is not the essential characteristic of our political system. The basic idiosyncrasy of the political system in Greece lies to the special relationship between economic and political elites. Historically, the Greek bourgeois class did not have any kind of Protestant capitalist ethic. From the beginning, it sought a role of parasitic symbiosis with the state apparatus. To put it in more simple words, the basic way to make money in Greece is not to produce something or to innovate something, is to have special political connections to the state. And this irrespectively to the political affiliation of the leading economic elites. For instance, the main industrial figure of the 12th century in Greece, industrialist Bodosakis, was a close friend in the 1930s of the liberal leader Venizelos. Then in the 60s was a close friend of the conservative leader Karamanlis, and finally it would also good businesses with the colonels during the dictatorship. As my friends and colleagues from the magazine Unfollow tried to show you yesterday, this is still the rule in Greece. For instance, the four magnates that control the basic media complexes in Greece do not own their newspapers or TV channels in order to gain money from that. All these media enterprises are in heavy debt. They use it in order to exchange the political influence they have by them, in order to gain political contracts, in other ways to exchange political influence with public money. This creates a very distorted institutional reality. The state in Greece cannot appear as neutral and above the social cleavages as in Europe. It is not possible to have a Weberian rational administration. And the legitimation of the state is not made possible through the normal ways of rational legal legitimation as in the average of the European states. Instead, it has been always ensured through networks of clientelistic relationships, both at the bottom, hiring personnel at the public services in order to have votes in the next elections, and at the top, this kind of closed symbiosis relationship I have tried to describe. In this framework, even the implementation of legality is selective. A famous speech of the Argentinian populist Perón describes the same reality in Greece. Perón has said in this famous speech that his motto was "A los amigos todo," to our friends everything, "A los enemigos nada," to our enemies nothing, "Al externo la ley," and only to those that are not either friends or foes, the implementation of law. That explains a paradox. In Greece, we have a very long, even with the European standards, parliamentary tradition. We have been among the first states that established a general electoral right in 1844, many decades before England, and we have a constitutional parliamentary life since then. Our first constitution of 1844 looks a lot like the Belgian constitution of 1831. But the institutional reality in Greece was far away from the institutional reality of Belgium, exactly because of this duality between the law in books and the law in the reality. This duality has reached its apex, almost its paroxysm, during the post-Civil War period in Greece. We had a civil war from 1945 to 1949 between communist and pro-Western forces. The pro-Western forces have been victorious, and after their victory, they have imposed a parliamentary state which was simultaneously a police state. According to some estimates, the informants of the police were in a rate analogous with this of Stasi in Eastern Germany. And during this period, we have had a new schizophrenic situation with regard to institutions and law. Not only we had the original duality between law in the books and how they have been implemented. Now we had a new internal schism, a new duality within the same the legal system. We had a constitution, the constitution of 1952, that protected individual freedoms and political rights. And parallelly to this constitution, we had a special corpus of legislation, laws of necessity, decrees laws, that imposed complete negation of political rights and individual freedoms. They allowed executions, deportations in massive scale. The constitutional theory in Greece describes this parallel corpus of legislation as a parallel constitution. The last thing I want you to have in mind in order to understand the institutional reality in Greece is that during these decades after our civil war, in Europe, we had the construction of the welfare state. The French call these three decades after the war, the Second World War, Les Trente Glorieuses, the 30 glorious years, because exactly they have been years in which the compromise between capital and labor in Europe managed to produce a new kind of model of capitalism, regulated through social rights and labor law, which is not ceased, of course, to be a system of market economy, but it was a system of market economy in a way much more protective for the workers than all the instances of the past. In Greece, never occurred during this period. Legitimation was not been achieved through a welfare state structure. Instead, we had the continuation of the same clientelistic and patronage relationships, and more on that, half of the society was practically outside both the political space and the possibility to have access to basic freedoms and liberties. This system of legitimation has collapsed after the fall of the dictatorship in 1975. The reason is simple. This arsenal, this mechanism of persecution against the political opponents, which was initially targeted only against the leftists and those who sympathized with them, during the dictatorship has turned against the whole of the society. So it was not anymore tenable. And with this mechanism of political persecutions collapsed also the official ideology that supported it, the anti-communism. The new unifying ideological concept after 1975 was modernization, catching up with Europe. And that coincided also with the strategic choice of the main political parties to enter the European Union. During this, let's say, 30 years since the fall of the dictatorship till the outburst of the recent crisis, we have made certain steps toward, let's say, normalization of the political life in Greece. For instance, in the 1980s, we ceased to have state trade unions. Till then, the leadership of the trade unions have been practically nominated by the state in a system of a very peculiar state corporatism. In the 1990s, we have tried to introduce a system of objective nominations, hirings, to the public services. We have also tried to pass a law that introduced a system of neo-corporatist framework between employers and employees, very similar to the European average. And in 2001, we have incorporated all these institutional changes to a sweeping revision of the Constitution that changed about 3/3 of its articles. During this time, it seemed that we have overpassed some of the bad institutional features of the past. I'm going to show you an example. This is a map, according to Privacy International, an NGO, that describes the degree of penetration of surveillance in different societies. The small green thing between Italy and Turkey is Greece. And as you can see, it is the only country that has green color. According to the Privacy International, in 2002, Greece was the only country that was conforming with the standards of transparency that these NGOs considered vital. However, this miracle did not last for long, exactly because it did not have deep roots. For instance, this special achievement with regard to surveillance was due to an independent authority established by this revision of 2001 that I have mentioned before, which did not manage to keep its competences for long. The political system looked at its dependency with a very bad eye. It used the general prosecutor in order to curtail initially the implementation of its competences, and then by a new legislation, practically it made it harmless for the political system. This happened because the political system has conserved this initial special characteristic that I have told you initially, that it is a salient feature of Greece. It continued to be a system of close interrelation of political and economic elites. And the democracy was functioning, but it was functioning to the extent that it did not harm the exercise of the powers of this closed system. And although we have, since the 80s, construction of a welfare state similar to the European one, for instance, we have the establishment of a national health system, still clientelism prevailed. For instance, we did not have, the only country now in Europe, a guaranteed minimum income for everybody, and the social legislation was fragmented in order to satisfy different needs of different clienteles. Finally, the economic and the political elites have not used the cheap money ensured by the low rates of loaning during this period in order to develop a new viable productive model. The European money has been used in order to boost private and public consumption. We had some investment in public roads, but not an investment, for instance, in railroads, exactly because there was not a possibility for the public contractors that had and still have this special relationship with the state to earn money by investing in the railways to the same extent that they could earn money by investing in construction of roads. And then the crisis hit us. You know that the official discourse in the European Union and in the majority of the northern states is that the crisis is due just to the excessive borrowing and the profligacy of the southern states. Nobody must absolve the Greek political system of its responsibilities. However, the crisis had much more structural causes. First of all, this narrative about huge borrowing is not corresponding with all countries that they have been hit by the crisis. Portugal, for instance, did not have either an excessive debt nor an excessive deficit. Moreover, this narrative hides a structural problem of the European Union. The fact that we have monetary union without an economic one. Why this is important? Have in mind that each time that a weaker economy is pegging its currency with a stronger, more competitive economy, we have inevitably flows of wealth, flows of money going out from the weaker to the stronger economy. This is not happening only when two different states are pegging their currency, as it happened, for instance, in Mexico, with Mexico and Argentina, which pegged the peso with the US dollar, or a decade earlier when this happened with Ireland vis-a-vis the British sterling. This is happening also in the interior of a federation. For instance, in the United States, stronger economies, such as New York or California, are having, during the economic year, a surplus with regard, for instance, to more to less developed agricultural states like this of the Midwest. But what is happening in a federal state? A part of the surpluses that the stronger economies have gathered are returned at the end of the financial year to the weaker economies, to the poorer federal states, through taxation or other social transfers. This is not happening in the European Union. The structural funds that are supposed to play this role have so little money that they cannot make a difference. You understand thus that the deficits of the South are just the other side of the coin of the surpluses of Germany and the other core countries. And this is not due just to some option of economic policies. It's inevitable as far as we have a euro which cannot be influenced by monetary decisions of the individual states, and we do not have any kind of transfer mechanisms able to transfer surpluses from the north, the core countries, especially Germany, to the south. Facing these structural problems, what has Troika tried to do? The memoranda, the political programs incorporated in these agreements, have nothing to do with the real problems of Greece. They have not touched either the problem of institutional legality that I have described at the beginning. They have not tried to resolve problems related to the irregular development of the welfare state. Quite the opposite, all their proposals are going towards the direction of dismantlement of the weak structures that we have managed to establish in Greece. And this is not something that we should not expect. The essence of the memoranda is this very known recipe of neoliberalism that we still define it as the Washington Consensus. Its essence is deregulation, privatizations, practically dismantlement of all protective legislation, something that it is not new in every European country. But what was the originality of the memoranda? Two things. First, they have tried to impose these reforms, structural reforms, in a very concentrated, politically way. To put it in simpler words, they have tried to pass too many things in too little time. And the most important, they have tried to impose, to dictate these measures from above, ignoring completely any kind of national democratic procedure. Thirdly, and very closely related to the second one, they have practically violated the majority of the constitutional provisions in trying to do that. Why? Why? First of all, the Greek Constitution of 1975, as the majority of the European constitutions, reflects a balance of power between capital and labor that is the balance of power in the 60s and in the 70s, a much more favorable balance for the forces of labor. Hence, they guarantee important social rights, both substantive rights to minimum wage, to pensions, to health, and also procedural social rights, the freedom to collective agreements, etc. All these rights are in strict contradiction with the recipe of neoliberalism. So, the first steps, the first measures imposed to us by the memoranda were aiming exactly at the dismantlement of these constitutionally protected provisions. Just an example in order not to waste a lot of your time. In 2012, all political parties, including the political parties that support the memoranda and the Troika, the Confederation of the Industrialists, and the General Confederation of the Trade Unions, all have agreed to keep the minimum salary intact, exactly as it has been agreed by a national collective agreement of the last year. Troika disagreed, and after an email of the Troika, this political consensus of all political parties, and above all, a collective agreement that was constitutionally protected, it has been abrogated by a unilateral legislative measure. You understand that this is not merely unconstitutional, it goes against the basic concept we have in the European societies that some issues should be decided by consensus, and if possible, some issues should be passed back to the bottom, to the social partners. Not only that, our Constitution provides that all international treaties, like the three loan treaties that we have been obliged to sign in order to receive the money, should be ratified by a law of the Parliament. None of the three loan treaties has come to the Parliament for ratification. The reason was that the political parties supporting the loan treaties were afraid that a number of members of the Parliament would not vote for them, exactly because they included a very, very exceptional waiver of immunity that extends also to issues of national sovereignty. There is not in any loan treaty I know any such waiver mentioning explicitly national sovereignty. It seems that I have overpassed the time, and I'm going to move a little faster. What was initially an assault to social rights, it then began to appear as an assault to individual freedoms. For instance, we had violent dispersions of peaceful demonstrations. We have had strikes declared illegal, and the workers on strike have been military enrolled in order to seize the strike. In other words, the attack to social rights, it has been transformed to an attack to civil ones. Again, this is something to be expected. Bourdieu, the known French theorist, says that when the left hand of the state, the hand that provides social rights, is weakening, then inevitably it is the right hand, the right of police and authoritarianism, that is getting stronger. In other words, we have a parallel constitution similar to the parallel constitution we had during the post-civil period, with the only difference that now it is not justified by as a state of emergency imposed by the necessity to repel the communist danger, but as a state of emergency related to the economic crisis. This has an effect, for instance, that in the freedom of press, Greece, in 2013, to be ranked among the most authoritarian regimes. For instance, as you can see in this table, in 2013 we have lost 15 places, in 2012 we have lost other 15 places, and now we are ranked below Gabon and Kyrgyzstan. I must conclude. The essence of the measures imposed to us are only quantitatively different than the measures of neoliberalism imposed to other countries of Europe. Greece has become a kind of extended laboratory to test the resistance of the society and the possibility to impose these measures. But for this reason, we have become a weak link for the neoliberal policies. Not only the economy is collapsing because the austerity is creating a vicious circle, not only these measures did not manage to reduce the debt, the public debt was in 2010 when we entered this mechanism of loaning, it was at 120% of our GNP, and now it is at 175%. Practically, it has become half bigger than it was. And of course, these numbers hide very badly innumerable disasters at individual and social levels. Pupils that go in hungry to the schools, patients that they do not have medicines. In other words, the medicine of Troika has proven to be more lethal than the crisis itself. The now raging humanitarian crisis in Greece has not been caused by the crisis, the economic crisis, by the measures taken to face it. But at the end of the day, the final dilemma is not if somebody is for or against the memoranda. It is not either at the technical level if one is for austerity measures or expansionist economic measures. The real dilemma that now we are facing throughout Europe is whether we are going to have social Europe or a neoliberal Europe. Under this prism, I think that we are all Greeks. Thank you very much.